Now I'm going to read you some things from Friedman, who wrote The Disappearance of God. He was trying to look at the underlying structure of the stories. Now, you know, Friedman noted that the books in the Old Testament were written by a lot of different people at very different times. And then they were sequenced by other people for reasons that we don't exactly understand. But there's still an underlying narrative. There's multiple underlying narrative unities, despite the fact of that rather arbitrary sequencing. And that's a strange thing. You know, I guess you could say, if you had a collection of ancient books and you were trying to put them together, you'd try to put them together in some way that made sense, right? And it wouldn't make sense unless you stumbled across some kind of underlying narrative that allowed you to order them. And so it's not entirely surprising that they're ordered in a manner that's comprehensible. But Friedman's comments on the underlying narrative structure, part of it was, well, we'll go through this. The books of the Old Testament were composed by a great many authors, according to both traditional religious views and modern critical scholarship. The phenomenon of the diminishing apparent presence of God across so many stories, through so many books, by so many authors, spread over so many centuries, is consistent enough to be striking, impressive, and ultimately mysterious. But the hiding of the divine face is only half the story. There's another development, also extending across the course of the entire narrative of the Hebrew Bible, which we must see before we can appreciate the full force of this phenomena, and before we can pose a solution to the mystery of how this happened. Gradually, from Genesis to Ezra and Esther, there is a transition from divine to human responsibility for life on earth. The story begins in Genesis with God in complete control of the creation, but by the end, humans have arrived at a stage at which, in all apparent ways, they have responsibility for the fate of the world. The first two human beings, Adam and Eve, take little responsibility themselves. They do not design or build anything. When they're embarrassed over their nudity, they do not make clothes. They cover themselves with leaves. It's God who makes their first clothing for them. Noah, by no means a fully developed personality, Noah is not an everyman either. Broadly speaking, he reflects a step beyond Adam and Eve in human character and responsibility. Abraham, beyond the accounts of divine commands that Abraham does carry out, the narrative also includes a variety of stories in which Abraham acts on his own initiative. He divides land with his nephew Lot. He battles kings. He takes concubines. He argues with his wife Sarah. On two occasions, he tells kings that Sarah is his sister out of fear that they will kill him to get his wife. And he arranges his son's marriage. In the place of the single story of Noah's drunkenness, there are, in the case of Abraham, the stories of a man's life. The Abraham section thus develops the personality and character of a man to a new degree in biblical narrative, while picturing in him a new degree of responsibility. It is not just that Abraham is kinder, gentler, more intrepid, more ethical, or a better debater than his ancestor Noah. Rather, both the Noah and the Abraham stories are pieces of a development of an increasingly stronger stance of humans relative to the deity. Before the story is over, humans will become a great deal stronger and bolder than Abraham. I don't know what that means, you know. See, it is certainly the case that the individual exists in the modern world, the differentiated, self-aware, self-conscious individual. And it's certainly the case that that wasn't the case at some point in the past. And so it's the case that there's been a development, I don't know if you could call it a progression, but a development of the autonomous individual over some span of historical time. Now, we don't know how long that's been, but my suspicions are it hasn't been that long. I mean, I read once about a Neolithic ceremony that involved the particular placement of a bear skull in a cave. And then I read that, and they had found these placements in caves that were at least 25,000 years old. And then I read that they found caves in Japan among the Ainu, who were the indigenous inhabitants of Japanese territory and rather archaic people, who had the same ceremony with the bear and that put the skull in the same orientation and place in caves, and that tradition remained unbroken for about 25,000 years. And you think, well, is it possible for an oral or ritual tradition to remain unbroken for spans of tens of thousands of years? And the answer to that is not only is it possible, it's actually the norm. Because like one chimpanzee is like the next chimpanzee, right? In the progression, in the biological progression. If you took a chimpanzee troop now and you went back 25,000 years and you looked at a chimpanzee troop, it'd be the same thing. There's no historical progression. That's how you can tell that chimps really don't have culture. Because if they could even accrete 1/1000th of a percent of culture, transmissible culture, per generation, it wouldn't take more than about 1 million years before they'd have a whole civilization. And they don't. They're the same as they were. And so the continuity, the stability, and unchanging nature of a species, essentially speaking, is the rule. The variant is us. It's like, what the hell happened after the last ice age, 15,000 years ago? We went from tribal, uniform, stable to whatever the hell we are now. It's this transition from generic to specific. It's something like that. And I can't help but think that that's reflected in this text and that it has something to do with this transition of consciousness from what? From possession by the generic divine to dominance by the specific individual. It's something like that. Is that a neurological transformation? Is that what this is a record of? I mean, we don't know. One of the things Jung said about God, because Jung's relationship with God as an object of belief is very complex. He, in his technical writing, he always talks about the image of God. He never talks about God. He talks about the image of God. He said that the image of God dwells within. That's not the same thing as God dwelling within, right? So we could, I mean, all of these capacities that we have for transcendent consciousness could be a byproduct of biological evolution. They could have no reflection. They can have no relationship whatsoever to an actual transcendent reality. There's no way of telling. The transcendent reality seems to manifest itself as an element of experience, but that doesn't mean that it has a reality outside of the subjective, even if it exists, as it clearly does. But Friedman suggests that what's happening in the biblical narrative is the sequential emergence of the individual as a redemptive force, and that the Old Testament documents that implicitly, unconsciously, as a consequence of descriptive fantasy, and that that's what's going on in the book. And that, so the cosmos is under the control of generic deity to begin with, something like that. And then that control shifts to localized, identifiable, increasingly personal and detailed individuals. And you see that in Noah, and then you see it in Abraham, and then you see it in Moses. And then there's this working out of what it would mean to be a fully developed individual. And that's what these stories, they're like prototypes. They're attempts to bring about the proper mode of being, right? And so Abraham is a manifestation of that because he enters into a covenant with God. He's selected by God or enters into a partnership with God. It's not exactly obvious. God provides him with forward motion and intuition and leads him towards a successful mode of being. And it's complex successful mode of being because Abraham has a very complex life. There's plenty of ups and downs, right? It's not unbroken purity of being towards a divine end. Abraham lies and cheats and deceives and does all sorts of things that a real person would do. And Moses, for example, kills someone. And so these people, the biblical people, are very genuine individuals. But they're given, with all their faults, right, with all their sins, with all their deceit, they're still put forth as potential modes of proper, models of potential proper being in the world. And the entire corpus of the Bible seems to be nothing but an attempt to keep throwing up variants of the personality, trying to experiment to find out what personality works in the world.